My name is Ben Capron, and on behalf of everyone at Specialized, I'd like to welcome you to the launch of the all-new Tarmac. Thanks for joining us this evening. Like you, all of us at Specialized are riders, and we thrive on creating bikes and equipment that improve the ride for all of us. It's this passion that makes this announcement of the all-new Tarmac so exciting for us. Like all the Tarmacs that came before it, this bike is about complete performance, providing a competitive advantage by combining all the attributes a competitive road racer needs. A bike that climbs as well as it descends, that corners as well as it sprints. But we're also here for a second reason, a bigger reason, to tell a story about a small team that made a big difference in the way bicycles will be developed forever. This new approach, which was inspired by our partners in Formula One racing, McLaren, begins and ends with the rider, which is why we've dubbed it Rider First Engineered. We'll be covering some new thinking tonight. You may have some questions. If you do, please post them or tweet them with hashtag #NewTarmac. And we'll be addressing as many of those as we can at the conclusion of the presentation. But for now, let's check out a short video that provides a great overview of the Rider First Engineered Tarmac.
Rider First Engineered is a different way of developing a bike platform. It's saying that a rider who's riding a 52 has a different set of needs than someone who's riding a 61. It's making sure that this bike performs at a level that we would expect across the entire size range. Rider First Engineered is definitely inspired by our relationship with McLaren. They really focus on data-driven design. So you need to sort of have the data in order to have a better understanding of the problem you're tackling. And we really use that approach on this project. So testing was a huge part of the development of the new Tarmac. We were really curious to really break down the dynamics of the steering of a bicycle and compare the reactions in the frame from a larger rider to a smaller rider. And we were measuring forces that travel through the fork, through the stem, into the seat. We're looking at inputs and outputs. Here we go, we got a lot of speed built up, and we have action here at the seat post. In the Tarmac SL4, we got some feedback that the smaller rider said on a bumpy corner, it has a bit of understeer, it tends to like push you out. And on the other end of the spectrum, for the larger rider, kind of the opposite of that. You know, it could be more responsive. So the goals when setting out to design the new Tarmac was to take that feedback and say, hey, you know, the guys riding the bigger bikes, they really need a stiffer platform because they're not lacking in stability in the corner, but they need more responsiveness. Yeah, he actually nailed that one. And on the other end, for these guys riding 49-52, we're saying, hey, we actually pushed it a little too far in stiffness with SL4. Why don't we dial that back while maintaining that agility, but give them more stability in the corners? And so that was really the approach on this bike. Oh, yeah.
That was awesome.
That was really good.
The results that we saw today really supported the rider first engineer concept. The guys were going on average about 1 to 1.5 Ks per hour quicker through the corner on the new Tarmac than SL4, and they were also getting more reaction from the bike.
Rider first engineered on this particular bike is critical. Everybody is gonna have the same experience. So a guy who's riding a 61 is going to have the same experience as a guy on a 49. They're all gonna ride like a Tarmac. It offers the rider the ultimate in stiffness and weight, the best sort of connection to the road in terms of handling, lightweight, and pedaling efficiency of any bike out there.
So we heard a lot there from Sam Pickman of Advanced R&D here at Specialized. We have Sam with us this evening. I'd love to invite him up on stage. Sam Pickman, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks, Ben.
So Sam's going to walk us through some of the finer points of the Rider First Engineered Tarmac. But first, Sam, can you, in a nutshell, explain why Rider First Engineered is such a significant concept.
Well, Ben, the big deal is that for the first time, no matter what size you ride, you can expect the same optimum performance. And it's never been done.
And so that's never been done in the past. Small riders and big riders had different performance out of their bikes?
Yeah, so basically, the industry up until this point, you design a 56 centimeter size medium to the best of your ability with the tools that you have. And then you just kind of scale it outwards to fill out the size range. But what we found through this process is that the riders' needs at each size are so drastically different that this approach just wasn't giving those riders the best performance.
And that was really the objective, right? That every rider of every size would have the same optimum performance.
Yeah, that's it. So we've sort of been under this assumption for years that if you or I were on a Tarmac, regardless of what size we were riding, we would essentially be having the same experience. Turns out, not the case. So on a bike like the Tarmac, we rely a lot on Pro Tour feedback. And when we released the SL4, we started to get some feedback from Alberto Contador and guys of similar size that, yeah, the bike felt great, but if they were in a bumpy corner, that it would kind of chatter and push them out of the corner.
And Alberto rides a 52, right?
Yeah,
so 54. A smaller rider.
Exactly. But, you know, when we started to get feedback from the bigger riders, you know, that just didn't exist. They weren't having that problem at all. So that was sort of the first clue that they were having entirely different experiences.
So you're getting different feedback from small riders than big riders, and that was kind of going on. You were hearing that, but then what next?
So probably best way to describe it is to go back to the inception of the idea. So Chris DeLucio, who rides a 52, he's a colleague of mine in advanced R&D. He's also one of my riding buddies. We were out on some, you know, pretty technical terrain here behind the office. It was, you know, broken pavement, kind of bumpy. He pulled up next to me and he's like, said something to the effect of, you know, how does your bike ride? I told him it was great. Best bike I'd ever ridden. He looked at me like I was crazy. He's like, you know, I don't know, man. It looks like you're having a hard time linking up those corners. I didn't know any better. I mean, I was on an SL4. It was really the benchmark in performance, right? So we kind of started to trade our feedback back and forth. I could tell he was onto something. And he just laid it out there. He says, you know, we're two experienced cyclists. We're both on Tarmacs. We're on the same piece of road at the same time, but we're having an entirely different experience.
And can you kind of specifically outline what the difference was in the experience that Chris and you were having?
Sure, it really backed up what the pros were telling us.
Okay.
I mean, Chris could use the bike to flick him in and out of a corner. The bike was very responsive underneath him, but if the road was bumpy, he was having a hard time controlling in the corners. Me, exactly the opposite. I was not really able to use the bike that well, and so I would have to anticipate corners, and because of that, I was having to adjust and correct mid-corner. But once I had the corner set, the bike tracked great.
Okay, so small riders had a real precise bike, but maybe one that was skipping through the turns, and you and larger riders were having bikes that were having a hard time initiating and exiting the turn, but working pretty well through the turn.
Correct, and really on that day, the hypothesis for Rider First Engineered was born. And it was basically saying that riders across the size range had entirely different needs. The size of a rider mattered way more than we thought. And our method of currently developing bikes just wasn't serving those riders.
Okay, so you had this hypothesis then that rider size mattered more than you thought and that you wanted to deliver optimal performance for every size rider. Mm-hmm. And what was the next step?
All right, so this is where a bulk of the project lived. We spent a lot of time on this. So as some of you may know, we have a strategic R&D partnership with McLaren. And along this process, we used a couple of McLaren style problem-solving processes that really helped us. So, you know, this partnership that we have with them, some of it has resulted in product, but a lot of it is in the back end. And how do you develop product? How do you engineer? How do you solve difficult problems? So on this particular project, we used two that they use all the time. Number one is driver in the loop, and number two is data-driven design. So driver in the loop basically says, okay, we have a machine, but we also have a human. And that human has feelings and sort of fuzzy feedback, right? But that stuff's really important. It's control, it's comfort, it's confidence, right?
So sort of qualitative
human
components.
So what McLaren has done and what they've sort of taught us how to do is how to take those sort of, you know, subjective feedback and turn it into something objective that you can design to. And then the second thing is the data-driven design. And what this says is it's kind of, you know, seems simple, but you need to have the data in order to make an informed decision. And that seems simple, yes, but you know the implications are actually big if you think about it.
So you need numbers if you're going to work to achieve those numbers, and the numbers need to correlate with real-world performance.
Right.
Got it. So once you saw that these two tools that you had learned from McLaren could be applied, how did you go about applying them for this particular project?
Okay, so we needed to figure out a way to get the rider in the loop, OK? kind of changed that a little bit for us. Riding a bike is actually a pretty complex thing. I'm gonna take the broom handle here. So riding a bike is unstable. It's not unlike balancing a broomstick like Ben's doing here.
Just happened to have a broomstick with us.
So you can see Ben has to constantly adjust to keep that broom handle upright. So riding a bike is really similar, okay? You're constantly playing a balancing game to keep the bike underneath you. If you try to just look at the system as the bike alone, you can't predict anything, right? You have to look at the system in total. So up until this point, that's exactly what we and the rest of the bike industry has done. We've analyzed the broom, or in our case, the bicycle alone, and ignored the biggest part of the system, the rider.
So how did you go about then bringing the rider in the loop? What did you use? What tools did you use to achieve that?
Okay, so to get the rider in the loop, as you guys saw in the video, we had riders on different size bikes across the size run, on instrumented bikes, going through a designated test course.
And so the instrumentation that you have are strain gauges, right, that measure the loads going into the frame in real time?
Correct. So sensors are a really critical part of getting the rider in the loop. In this particular case, we were using strain gauges bonded to the stem, to the seat post, the fork, and the frame, and we were looking at how loads get transmitted from the rider down through the bike to the road, and then back from the road up to the rider.
And so then you had numbers, and then you had the qualitative feedback from the riders, and did that start to correlate?
Yeah, so let's break down the testing a little bit. So we really wanted to focus on initiating a corner, riding through the corner, and then steering out of that corner to set up for the next. And when we looked at that data, and we took the rider feedback, and we analyzed the video, the rider-first hypothesis was really starting to be realized. And we were starting to gain a really deep understanding of the problem.
So now what was a fuzzy idea that different riders had different needs was starting to come into clarity. You had numbers behind it because rider was in the loop. And talk to us about the next steps of the development process.
All right, so from here, we have to take all this information and go back to the test lab and start to set targets to design a new bike to, because that's why we're here, right, to design a new bike. So actually, we ran into some serious problems. We brought all these numbers back, we set it up on our current test jigs, and we noticed something pretty obvious, that there was a huge hole in our testing. We didn't have anything representing the rider. So we test, just like the rest of the industry does, a static test table, and we look at really just the frame alone. But what we found is it just didn't predict performance properly. So we spent the next few months going about including a rider in our testing. So now, to predict performance, we have a dynamic test, so everything is moving, and we actually have an analog for the rider on top of the bicycle. So now we can truly predict performance.
So you were able to determine or simulate the rider in a lab situation. So it was a dynamic test, a moving test, and then that correlated. And then that enabled you to create targets for each size that you could give to the design engineers, is that right?
Yes, so now we had seven discrete sizes with seven discrete targets based on this test. And we engineered each one individually to make sure that those riders were getting the maximum performance.
Whoa. Okay, so yeah. So then we've covered a lot of territory there. So you wanna kinda summarize it for us?
Sure, let's recap. So number one, forces exerted across a frame size, they're not consistent. So that old way of designing a medium or 56 centimeter frame and scaling outwards, it's just not cutting it. You have to treat each frame like it's its own platform with discrete targets in order to achieve the same level of performance.
Okay.
Number two, a new way of testing. So our old method of static testing just wasn't putting the rider in the loop. So through this process, we have a new method of dynamic testing with an analog for a rider that truly predicts performance. Number three, rider-specific performance achieved. So the Tarmac, it has to be great handling, compliance, and best power transfer. So through this process and all this learning, we've achieved that on every single size. And through the process, we kind of learned a couple counterintuitive things. So on the smaller size bikes, like we were talking about, we actually figured out that you have to turn down stiffness in some cases in order to increase performance. So higher stiffness doesn't always mean higher performance. This is kind of a new idea for the bike industry. And on the bigger end, we realized we had to turn it way up to get that same performance. So, you know, some interesting learning.
And you touched on something really important there. We spent a lot of time talking about large riders and small riders and looking at going through turns, but I think you touched on a really critical part. You were able through this process to determine the right numbers to achieve complete performance. Yes, handling, but also power transfer and other attributes, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so that's a great summary, but we know you're all out there thinking, there's only one bike I care about, mine. So let's go ahead and review Rider First Engineered and what it delivers for small riders, medium riders, and large riders. Let's hit the small riders first. Small riders in the Rider First Engineered Tarmac are gonna see optimal in-cornering, in-corner handling. We talked about that a lot. So this means that you won't have the chatter through those rougher turns that you may have experienced in the past. Optimal handling in the corners. Improved vertical compliance is something we've been able to build into all of the Rider First Engineered Tarmacs, approximately 10%. That means that the bike is smoother, and as we know, smoother is faster. So you're gonna be less fatigued, more energy at the end of your ride when it's time to ramp it up for that final sprint. Speaking about sprinting and power transfer, a 17% increase in power transfer. These are massive numbers. Double digit gains at this level of evolution is really significant. So that means every watt that you put into the pedal goes into forward motion as efficiently and rapidly as possible. And along the way, we were able to pick up reduced aerodynamic drag. And as we know, at the speeds we ride these bikes, drag is one of the primary factors that we're fighting. Again, we're making the most of the watts you put into the machine. Mid-size riders, improved steering response. So what we found as Sam took us through was the initiating and exiting the turns. The steering response was where we had to tune up, starting at mid-size and ramping our way up. So improved steering response, better ride compliance, as we mentioned, a 15% increase in power transfer. Again, a much more effective use of the rider's power to the pedals, and reduced aerodynamic drag on the mid-size bikes as well. As Sam noted, the large riders are going to have an absolute revelation from this bike, because never before have the large riders known a bike that handles as precisely as smaller riders have. This was one of the big revelations, a 28% increase in steering precision. And this is a number you can see on a screen, but really it's one that you need to experience to believe. These are really riders' bikes, and when you spend time in the saddle on the new Rider First Engineered Tarmac, you feel it immediately. And then you also pick up the 16% increase in power transfer. So at every size rider, at every attribute required for complete performance, the new Tarmac has really raised the bar of performance. But you've heard a lot from us. Along the way, as Sam mentioned, we've worked with some of the best riders in the world, and we have a video clip of some of these riders and what their impression has been of the bicycle when they've been doing some of the testing. Let's check that out now.
The feedback that we've got on the new Tarmac from the pros that we work with has been phenomenal.
Tutto più, tutto più naturale, tutto che segue di più la curva, cambi di direzione migliore.
Si può notare subito una rigidità molto, molto diversa, specialmente quella torsionale di quando si tratta in curva.
Tarmac, you can take really fast the sharp corners, and a push goes into acceleration straight away.
Le transmite a los pedales, la bici la devuelve y la transmite a la carretera. Entonces es una bici super, super.
E invece per quanto riguarda la nuova Tarmac, è un'evoluzione completa della vecchia Tarmac.
Fantastic, and now we've got a more complete representation of the team that was behind the creation of Rider First Engineered Tarmac. We've already heard from Sam, but we have Chris DeLuzio, who's Sam's partner in advanced R&D. We've got Eric Schuda, who's the product manager for all the performance road bikes. We've got Luke Callahan, one of the key engineers on all of our road projects here at Specialized. And we've got some questions that have come in. Been posted on various forums, and the first one I will give to Luke. Luke, Chris from the USA asked, isn't Rider First Engineered pretty much the same as size specific that I've heard you guys talk about in the past?
Okay, so actually there's a really big difference. With size specific engineering, something that we've done for years, and actually we've led the industry on in scaling different sizes of bikes. Really, that didn't take into account what we did in Rider First Engineering. So Rider First Engineering, we really took a step back, slowed down, and redefined how we define engineering targets. Now with that, it means that we had an independent engineering target for each size of bike, something we've never done before. And that's really the main difference between size-specific and rider-first. It also means that with rider-first engineering, one target for each size of bike. We had to do computer simulations 7 times, and that resulted in tube shapes that are drastically different from large to small size. Really, when you hold up a 49 and a 64, the tube shapes are really, really different. In addition, the composite layup that we use on all the different sizes was developed ground up, basically as a new layup to hit those targets again. And really, the proof is in the ride, so the targets means the ride.
And when you said we've never done that before, really no one's ever done that before, right?
We as a bike engineer and designers, I think as a whole industry, it's a first.
Okay, yeah. Fantastic. That's what I was looking for. I'm going to give this one to Sam. Sam Allen asks, how about us wider riders, aka us mere humans? How does the ride change? I think what he's getting at here is we're talking about size, but are we talking about, what about if someone weighs more and they're the same height? Does weight matter in the performance of the bike?
All right, I think I know where you're getting at.
Okay. I think so that's
what weight matters as much as height.
Yeah. All yeah, right. what about weight differences?
Okay, so yeah, I mean, obviously weight does matter. If you have two riders on the same size bike, actually, we've actually broken this down.
Mm-hmm.
All right, let me think back a second. If you have two riders of the same size, right, and they are, like, let's say 10% different in weight, you get about 10% different in force on the frame. But if you have two riders and one has a 10% higher saddle height, the forces on the frame go up to 18% higher. So it's actually a bigger driver in the forces that go to the frame, height versus weight.
So if two riders of the same weight have a 10% difference in seat post extension or saddle to bottom bracket, it's 18% increase in force at the frame.
Correct.
Whoa, almost double.
Yeah.
Okay, so there you go, Alan. Weight does matter, but not as much as height. All right, here's a good one for Eric. Eric, Bruno from Mexico asks, I ride a 56. Is there any real advantage for me at that frame size?
Yes, Bruno, the answer is yes. So with the new Tarmac, you need to remember that the bike was developed dynamically. So what that means is in making a dynamic bike, we're able to further optimize the power transfer. It's up about 15% for your size. The bike is more aerodynamic, and it also has improved steering response through some new shaping and layups in the fork and in the frame as well.
Awesome, thanks. I'm going to give this one to you as well, Eric. And we didn't mention, but we should have mentioned, that all the Rider First engineered models, and there will be three, all come either with rim brakes or with disc brakes. I think that this CNR Casey must have already gone to the website and seen that information, because I don't think we've revealed it here tonight. So good on you, CNR Casey. Anyway, he asks about disc brakes. Why are there discs on the new Tarmac?
Yeah, well, first off, at Specialized, we believe that disc brakes are the future of performance road bikes. With a complete bike like the Tarmac, where we've made a bike that handles better, it climbs better, it descends better, really making the bike more complete is putting hydraulic disc brakes on there. It takes the whole experience and raises it to the next level. It's more confident descending, you can brake later, you can hit the corners harder. The bike now brakes the same in all weather conditions, so it really just rounds out the package, unleashes the potential, and completes the performance.
Unleashes the potential. Good stuff. Okay, with that, I'm getting the signal that we've run out of time this evening. I want to start, as we concluded, from all of us at Specialized, thanking you for being a part of this important launch for us and a new step in bicycle development. Thanks so much for tuning in. Please be sure to go to specialized.com to find more information and go to your Specialized dealers to ride one of the bikes. They'll start shipping on Monday. Thank you all very much.